On today's episode, it's all about the drawer frames.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop, sponsored by
Microjig, maker of the Gripper. Work safer, work smarter.
Detailed plans for the 8-drawer tall dresser featured in today's episode are available for sale in the digital download store at mattsbasementworkshop.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So as I mentioned at the beginning of the episode, today's show is primarily all about the construction of all of these drawer frames. Right now they are pretty much completed. We do have an extra step which we'll cover in the next episode to finish up the construction of these drawer frames because we have a lot of material to cover in today's episode. But really when it comes down to it, really simple, and there's a couple of different ways to create them, but I'm going to show you the one that I chose to go with. But more about that in just a second. One thing I want to do before we jump into the construction of these drawer frames is we need to revisit something from the last episode, and that is, now that we have all of the sides created and we've got our dados and our rabbets in place, I want to come through and I need to make a slight adjustment. Now, once I had the drawer frames all set, I did a quick dry fit. Everything is working exactly the way I was hoping to, falling right into place. But oftentimes, whenever I use a stacked dado head cutter, what I end up finding is that there's some slight variations along the length. And to some degree, with a router, I've run into this issue a little bit, but it's more with the stacked dado than anything else. So there may be just a slight height differentiation at the front and the end than there is, say, in the middle. This is easily, as far as I know and have had a little bit of success with, it's really easy to just make sure that you maintain the pressure right over the cutter head. But as you know, sometimes you're pushing that panel through, you may find yourself putting more pressure at one end and the other, just as you're pushing the panel. It ends up happening. It's not that big of a deal. You can leave it this way. You're not going to have significant issues with it. But what I like to do is to come back in with a router plane and then just simply set it to the right depth. I only want to remove a little bit of material, and I'll show you this in just a second, and then we'll just even out those dados. So before we get started on those frames, like I said, let's go ahead and take a quick gander at how to clean up these depths, and then we'll move right into the frame construction. So as I alluded to just a few seconds ago, it's not unusual to find that after I cut my dado or rabbet with the stacked dado head cutter, there's a slight variation in the depth along the entire length of it. And typically, I'll often find it here towards the center of the panel. Like I mentioned, it has everything to do with the pressure that I'm pushing on the panel as it goes over the cutter head. Apparently, I'm really varying it quite a bit, but that's no big deal for me because I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to grab my router plane, which I will have at a set depth to go ahead and clear this out. Now, the way that I set the depth is oftentimes I'll discover that the final depth that I really want is more here at the very beginning or say here at the end, and so it's only stuff here in the middle that I need to clean. So I'll set my depth for the blade somewhere around this. In fact, what I might normally do is I'll start just a little bit higher and then work my way down. The neat thing is with these, they have on this particular model at least, they have a nice depth stop on here, so I can start a little bit higher and then bring it down, much like you would do with, say, just like some router bits or something where you can't necessarily go into the full depth. For me, I'm going to go ahead and start my cut. You know what, let's just find out how bad it really is. So I'm going to start somewhere here in the center, and I can feel that the body's rocking as I get to it. So I know that area needs to be cleaned up. Same here. This one's not so bad, so I know that's maybe a good spot. But if I were to push this forward, this is my show face. And I could easily, in fact, I'm starting to engage in something right here. If I'm pushing too much, I could blow this out. So what I like to do is, especially here on the show face, I'll turn the plane around and I'll pull it towards me. It doesn't matter whether you push or you pull, you're going to get the same exact effect if you're doing it the right way. So we'll turn it this way, and I'm going to go ahead and gauge. And you're going to feel it as you go across. You're going to see it for sure. It's going to kind of skip and jump across where it's hitting. And so I'm way off down here. So I am definitely hitting some stuff. And I'm getting close to this end here, so I'm gonna have to turn it around. Yeah. All right, so I did this one side here. So let's come down the other side of this groove, of this dado. All right, that feels good. Nothing engaging anything. All right, so here we go. Oh, I'm starting to get some, there we go. All right. So I'll go ahead and I'll bring the camera around here and I'll show you how I'm going to finish this little portion off here. Okay, so you can kind of see everything that we've worked up here. So let's go ahead and get some of this junk out of the way. And then now, again, we're just going to go ahead and turn this around and we're going to come in from the back. So the main thing is, notice I'm trying to push down on the front here to make sure that it is engaging with the surface. And ooh, that's a deep cut. I really was off in the back here. I might even want to come in and score these shoulders so that I don't tear too much. Give me a little, there we go. All right, well, that takes care of it. It is now nice and flat. And if I really felt like I needed to, I would just simply reset the depth stop here. And you can see right here, this is the depth stop that I was talking about, so that it drops just a little bit more. But I'm happy with this. So now that this first one's done, I'm gonna go ahead and move on to the others. Now that I have the interior dados all done, I need to turn to the rabbet and clean this one out also. Whenever you are working with something where you don't have a second face to reference for the plane, it's always important to put some sort of support piece that's the same exact thickness to make sure that whenever you have your planing action, if you do hit a rough area, you might be surprised to find that you are suddenly putting pressure on that outside piece. If the support piece wasn't there, you could potentially tip the router plane and then now you'll have a slightly slanted face for your rabbet. So it's always a good idea to kind of, ooh, I got a little bit of work to do here, to come back in and again, make sure you have that support piece. So I'm gonna finish these up and now it's really time to head over to start working on the frames. So let's go ahead and turn our attention to the construction of the drawer frames for the rest of this episode. And the first thing we need to do, of course, is to mill our stock.
We start the milling process over at the joiner. Here we're flattening the first face of some stock that we're gonna eventually be using for some sides and centers of our drawer frames. Now this particular board obviously has some twists in it, so it's gonna take a few passes to get it flattened. Next, we'll mill the stock for our longer front and back rails, taking the time to check it with a long straight edge to make sure any bow along the length is adequately removed. Once all the stock is jointed, it's then over to the thickness planer. Then finally, once more, it's back over to the joiner to square up one edge for our next stop in the dimensioning process, which is ripping to width from the table saw. But in this particular case, we're only going to be ripping the long front and back rails. For the sides and centers, I'm going to first cross-cut them to length using my cross-cut sled, squaring up one end first. Then I'll set up a stop block and cut the other ends to the final length required. And since I already ripped the long front and back rails to width, and I have the cross-cut sled all set up, I'm gonna go ahead and cut these to length also. Finally, I'm going to reinstall the blade guard and rip fence and rip the shorter ends and centers to their final widths.
So at this point, all of the components for the drawer frames are cut to their final dimensions, which means it's time to start thinking about the joinery techniques we're going to use to bring it all together. This is one of those things where we could use, rather easily as far as I'm concerned, non-traditional joinery such as pocket hole joints or biscuits or dowels or even floating tenons or something along the lines of that. But in my case, I want to use a tongue and groove system. So I have this really nice router bit set that I got from Whiteside years ago, and I've had really good results with it. It does take a few minutes to get it set up, so I'll show you how I get things set up with it to get the results, and of course then I'll show you the actual cutting action itself. But really when it comes down to it, this is something that if you don't have a set like this, you could use, say, a straight cutting router bit, or you could even use, again, the stack dado cutter over at the table saw, or even just a regular blade where you just have to kind of nibble away at it. But really, all we're doing for this is creating a groove in which a tenon is going to be set in, a rather short stub tenon. So again, like I said, you can use other tools for it, such as those straight cutters and the stack dado head. But since I have this on hand and I'm familiar with it and I know I get great results with it, I'm going to go ahead and do it. So let's take a look at the setup and then run the pieces.
Before we go any further, I just want to remind you that with a router bit set like this, there's two things to keep in mind. One, only use it on the router table. And two, make sure to take several passes to test fit this to make sure that you can get it dialed in just the right way. Now, once we have it in place, to help minimize any chance of tear out, I'm going to take advantage of the inserts in my router fence, which are completely movable, and I'm going to create a zero clearance fence. To ensure the stock stays tight to the face of the router table and tight to the router fence, I install a few feather boards and then I run my stock through the cutter. Once all the long front and back rails have been grooved with the slot cutter, it's time to replace it with the tenon cutters. This router lift on the table does a great job of making this task a lot easier. Now, to help dial in the fit, I'll use a piece with an existing groove to help me gauge where to start my test fits. I then adjust my fence inserts to yet again create another zero clearance fence. I take a test pass or two, and as you can see, it shows me I'm really close, but yet I still have to dial it in just a little bit more. And then when it's finally dialed in, it's time to start cutting the tenons to fit those grooves. Here you can see I'm using a miter gauge with a backer board installed to help support the piece and, of course, to minimize the amount of tear out on the backside. Once everything is routed, it's time to start the assembly process, and we're going to do this over at the workbench. Now I start by finding the center of the front and rear rails. Then using an adjustable square already set to the right measurement, I mark the center of the shorter center rail. To ensure that I'm actually centered, I measure and mark from both edges. Now this just happens to be a quirky little habit that I picked up for this build, but it's given me such a true center that I think I might start using it elsewhere. Now with everything marked, it's a matter of inserting the stub tenon into the slots and lining up those marks. For most of the frames we're assembling, they consist of two long front and rear rails, two short sides, and a short center rail. But for the drawer frames supporting the smaller drawers up top, we'll need to add two more short center supports. To locate these, I locate the center between the side and center rails. Then it's a matter of marking it and repeating the process as we did for all of the other center rails. Once we have the first one done, we'll just simply repeat it on the other end. At this point, it's time to start the glue up process. Now, because there's a lot of pieces to glue up, I want to work quickly, especially because this is a rather dry basement this time of year, thanks to the forest air furnace that you probably keep hearing in the background. Of course, this footage is obviously sped up, or at least hopefully it's obvious, but you get the idea. Glue on the tenons, then line them up in position, adjust as needed. And because I like using web clamps for this task, and I only have a couple of them, I'm going to gang the glue ups together. To keep them from sticking to each other, I'm just gonna lay down some wax paper in between, and then I'm gonna start the glue up for the next frame. Then, it's all a matter of installing the web clamp, adjusting as necessary, which includes using a regular clamp maybe to tighten up any of the joinery that has slipped because of the glue. And then finally, it's time to check for square once everything's in position. Start at one corner, then the other, and it's all good to go. For the most part, the bottom drawer frame really isn't all that different from the rest. The long rails are obviously wider, and in the plan, there's no mention of inserts, but for this one, I'm gonna add them, just in case something falls out of the drawer. I don't know, it'll be contained rather than being on the floor. Now these are really easy to add. Just simply cross cut, and then rip the panels to length. And when you're at the router cutting the slots and tenons, just remember to add some slots to the short rails. Then simply assemble. And eventually clamp in place like you did for all the others.
All right, folks, so this is a pretty good place to stop today's episode. We covered a lot of information, starting, of course, with those dados and then working our way to the construction of the drawer frames that we have here. Now, the drawer frames are about 95% completed. We'll finish them up entirely in the next episode where we have to plow out a groove for a drawer guide that we're going to be installing. But we'll talk more about that again in the next episode. One thing I do want to emphasize, and I mentioned this when I was talking about the joinery that we used with the router bits here, is if you opt to go with a non-traditional joinery such as a pocket hole joint or dowels or biscuits or something like that, it's really important to pay attention to the actual dimensions that are listed in the plans that we have for this drawer frame assembly. Of course, you can find the plans over at Matt's Basement Workshop /digital downloads. They're available for purchase right now. But the one thing you'll notice in here is in the cut list and in the plans themselves, we already are assuming that you're going to use this tongue and groove joinery. If you're not, and you are going to go with something that requires a butt joint right here, make sure that you remove that 3/8 extra material, 3/8 inch extra material at the top and the bottom. I have done this not with this plan, thankfully, but with other plans where I follow along with something that I originally intended to use and then opted to alter it at the last second and suddenly discovered that now the component is actually oversized because I forgot to adjust those dimensions. So definitely pay close attention to something like that. But anyways, if you have comments, questions, suggestions, I love hearing from all of you. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com, or you can stop by the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com and leave a comment in the show notes over there. Or if you happen to be watching this at YouTube, you can leave a comment there. I love hearing from all of you. So until the next time, I will be talking to you soon. Straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. Detailed plans for the 8-drawer tall dresser featured in today's episode are available for sale in the digital download store at mattsbasementworkshop.com. Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/mattsbasementworkshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.